to another edition of History on Tape, the program where we talk to historians about their work and ideas. My name is Oscar Broughton. Today, I'm joined by the historian Felipe Corrêa of the Institute of Anarchist Theory and History here in São Paulo, Brazil. He's a specialist in the history of anarchism and has a particular interest in the anarchist revolutionary Michel Bakunin and the Italian revolutionary Errico Malatesta. He's published numerous works, including this, his latest work, Black Flag, A Rediscussion of Anarchism. And today we'll be talking about the history of anarchism in Brazil, global history, and how these topics intersect with the current political situation in Brazil. Felipe, welcome.
Thank you very much.
To start, where does the history of anarchism in Brazil begin? And how do global factors such as migration, industrialization, and colonialism help to shape this history?
In fact, anarchism develops in Brazil exactly in the end of the 19th century and completely develops and articulates in the beginning of the 20th. Normally, people used to say that anarchism was brought by the immigrants, but in fact, that's considered an old approach. You know, in fact, taking this perspective we are working with, we could say that anarchism in Brazil, it's a result of some contexts that mix together all these features you've mentioned. Mm-hmm. Okay, so first one, sure, immigrants had a hold, particularly in São Paulo, okay, Italians in São Paulo and Portuguese in Rio, but I do not consider it's something that were just brought from abroad, mm-hmm. You know. This is a really conservative thesis that was promoted here in Brazil during too much time, saying that Brazil was a calm country and so on, and just the immigrants brought these ideas of class struggle, of social struggle, of popular movements and so on. So I do not agree with this, and I think that sure, as I said, immigrants brought some ideas, some practices, but you have always together an Indian tradition of struggles. So if you see the history of Brazil, you will find a lot of interesting struggle history showing how black people, how Indians, how workers developed a lot of struggles to deal with the oppressions in general. So the second feature of this movement that emerges in the end of the 19th and the beginning of the 20th is this Indian tradition of social struggle, let's say. And also this economic and political context that will contribute with that. But anarchism develops in an union, let's say, of this tradition of indigenous thought and practices and immigrant thoughts and practices, and then the influence of the global anarchist movement that was being developed in some other countries. Here in Brazil, differently of other Latin American countries, we had an influence of the French tradition that was really important. If you see in 1906, it occurred in Brazil, the first Workers' Congress, mm-hmm. And there is a mention on the French CGT, okay, funded in 1895, mm-hmm. And then we could say that all this process of the French CGT and also the Charte d'Amiens and other important elements of syndicalist movement in France influenced too much the Brazilian movement.
Mm-hmm.
Also, a second influence of the Latin American movement, particularly Argentinian fora.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so we can understand the Brazilian anarchism being formed by this network of immigrants, of Indian social struggles, and then the influence of these two models of syndicalism. First one more important, the French one. Second one also important, but not as important as the French one, the Argentinian model. Basically, we could say that the anarchist tradition in Brazil developed through the strategy of syndicalism.
Mm-hmm.
So, Brazilian history of anarchism in the beginning of the 20th century is a bit typical,
mm-hmm.
let's say, okay? So anarchism develops among workers and rapidly it transforms into the most influential ideology among the workers' movement.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so in the first two decades in Brazil, anarchism will be the most strong ideology among workers. And the main initiative among anarchists was syndicalism.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So anarchists here in Brazil developed a lot of activities. So they developed some newspapers, let's say Terra Livre, let's say A Voz do Trabalhador,
mm-hmm.
a lot of them. La Batalha, okay? There was a lot of newspapers. Some of these newspapers also with news in other languages and starting a dialogue among immigrants and so on.
Mm-hmm.
They worked on rational schools. Okay, so there is also a tradition of libertarian schools here in Brazil. Some initiatives of anarchists organizations, okay, specific anarchists political organizations, as the Anarchist Alliance in Rio, as the first communist party,
mm-hmm.
that it's a Brazilian party before the 22's communist party influenced by Bolshevism.
Mm.
But I'm saying all that to say that all these initiatives were really important, really strong, but the main one was syndicalism. So the main activity anarchists were doing here in Brazil was syndicalism. First, building unions, organizing workers, demanding and struggling for social reforms, for economic immediate gains, and trying to connect this with a revolutionary project.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and normally the models of the unions here in Brazil were inspired in the French CGT, or this idea of the political neutrality of the unions and so on. So the idea was that all the workers could participate inside the unions, but the anarchists were promoting a kind of model of syndicalism and trying to influence these unions to adopt this direct action syndicalism, this grassroots built syndicalism, this movement that connects the struggle for reforms and the struggle for a revolution. And so the idea was to unite all workers and then to promote by this revolutionary gymnasium, let's say, to promote this issues and this project of social change, let's say.
Mm-hmm. So you've already touched upon how anarchism in Brazil was not just a European import. So how can we talk about a global history of anarchism, which includes Brazil, but tell a non-Eurocentric history about this?
Yeah, in fact, this point is really relevant because I'm studying a lot of historic examples. I'm studying a lot of episodes among anarchism is involved with. And then I can affirm that anarchism cannot be comprehended with a national history, mm-hmm. you know, and with a Eurocentric history, with a history from abroad, from, how do I say, the contrary of history from below.
History from above.
Above, yeah, that's all I'm talking about. And what we're saying, what we're discovering in our studies is that anarchism cannot be well comprehended by national histories or by Eurocentric histories or the history from above, you know. So there is a need to understand the anarchist history to use a different perspective. Okay, we need to think in the global networks, in the global contexts, in the global links among the anarchist universe, let's say that, and to contextualize the anarchist theory and history. You know? So we could use an example, but if we're investigating how anarchism emerges, then we can see that people are traveling, people are communicating, people are sending newspapers, people are sending letters, and so on. So there is the possibility to investigate all these networks and to rediscover or to reconstruct this nodes, let's say, among the anarchist tradition. I'm saying that because, let's say, if we're investigating how anarchism arrives in Africa, we will see that there is a hole that is really relevant of the Italian anarchists in Egypt. Okay, they went there for working and also for political asylum. And then anarchism starts to develop there because of this relation, let's say. But this is not a relation that goes from Central Europe to other places, okay? There exists movement in the contrary sense, let's say. In Brazil, there is a tradition of a lot of immigrants that came to Brazil and they become anarchists in Brazil and then they return to Europe to promote anarchism there. This anarchism that that was learned in Brazil. If we see, if we study, let's say, the syndicalist movement, we could see that there is an influence that it's really great on the Spanish CNT by the Argentinian syndicalist movement. Okay, so at the same time, an influence in the 19th century, okay, for the development of anarchism in the in countries as Argentina, Uruguay, and others. So the first international branch in Spain had this important important influence here, but after we can see this influence in the contrary side, let's say. Okay, so the Argentinians influencing the formation of the CNT, and so the some important features of the Spanish anarchist circle. So our idea is that we have to do with anarchist history what historians are doing in other fields. Mm-hmm. Okay, so we have to work with this global history that can identificate these links, basically based on communication and transportation. Mm. Okay, because there is an important discussion on that. That this development of the transportation, of transport and of communication. Okay, it's a capitalist feature of the 19th. It's really important because together with the capitalist development, it also you can also identify the development of these anarchist nodes of this anarchist articulations. Mm-hmm. Let's say anarchists are traveling, and they're traveling because of work, because of political repression, because of militancy interests. Okay, they are sending newspapers. Okay, the Bakunin Alliance, for you to have an idea, sent a lot of newspapers to Uruguay. Mm-hmm. And anarchism develops in Uruguay with an important influence of these newspapers that were sent, like previous to the clash of 1872. Mm-hmm. Okay, so I think we can stop. We have to stop to do this national histories and to identify that there is an international influence, and this influence is not from Europe to Latin America, from Europe to Africa, from Europe to Asia. So we need to understand this global history, okay, without a center, and also without the great man. Mm-hmm. Okay, the history of anarchism is not the history of Bakunin, it's not the history of Malatesta, it's not the history of Kropotkin. Mm-hmm. Okay, Bakunin, Kropotkin, Malatesta surely are really important anarchists, but they are related to a complex context. They are related to some social struggles, some workers' movements, and so on. And these movements are always important to establish their point of view or their conception of anarchism. Mm-hmm. Let's say if we're studying Bakunin, you will see that the strikes of 1868, mm-hmm. okay, in some countries in Europe, had a profound impact in his views on class, on syndicalism, and so on, and in my point of view, are something that is completely central to understand his last transformation into an anarchist, mm-hmm. let's say. Okay, so I think we have to put these great authors inside, okay, a biggest context, and understand their relation to other, their relation to some other Indian traditions. Okay, so here, if you're studying anarchism in Latin America, you will see in countries like Mexico or in Peru that there is an integration between the anarchist tradition and also the agrarian Indian tradition, mm-hmm. and transforming into other stuff. We could call it anarchism, surely, but it's not the same anarchism we see in Europe. So what we're discovering is that anarchism has a kind of a general approach, a general perspective, some features of continuity, of permanence,
mm-hmm.
okay, that we can identify. It keeps this ideal alive from more than 100 years,
mm-hmm.
but at the same time we can identify that this ideology or this doctrine has an immense capacity of adapting itself to different contexts.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so it could be adapted to contexts of fuel industrialization and peasant movements. It could adapt in some countries that were marked mainly by the introduction of capitalism into the camps, you know, so among workers,
mm-hmm.
In the fields and countryside and so on. And then we can also identify, and it's important to say that contrary to the main history, that's the part where anarchism developed mostly in industrial contexts. Okay, if we see that thesis normally promoted by Marxists saying that as the industrialization develops, anarchism disappears,
mm-hmm.
this thesis it's basically wrong. There is no history to confirm it. Okay, it's just an affirmation without a basis, because
mm-hmm.
what we see is exactly the contrary.
Mm-hmm.
Where industrialization develops, anarchism develops. Okay, so we have anarchism being developed exactly in the countries that promotes industrialization and so on, but that does not mean that anarchism just couldn't adapt in some other pre-capitalist context, let's say.
Mm.
So anarchism has an interesting history on among peasants, among rural workers,
mm-hmm.
and also among industrial workers. So this idea of the revolutionary subject, that it's being constructed not by their social position, but
mm-hmm.
by the process of class struggle and so on, is really something applied in different countries and showing these interactions about where the ideology, the context, and other important elements are articulated, forming one whole stuff that we could call the anarchist tradition or something.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so maybe it's important to construct this new perspective of studying anarchism, to stop repeating things we are repeating that we cannot find some basis on history, because something we identified is that even sympathetic authors, when studying anarchism, repeat all this stuff, like anarchism was promoted mainly among peasants.
Mm-hmm.
Anarchism is normally connected to some lack of political maturity.
Mm.
Anarchism develops in Europe by persons like Marxist Jr. or others like that. So we need to question this affirmation and to re-investigate things, to stop repeating things that are being repeated for long years, you know.
Well, I think that this tendency of anarchist histories is probably because of the close proximity to other leftist histories, specifically Marxist histories. And like you say, we need to perhaps move away from those tendencies in order to discover global perspectives, perhaps. And maybe, as you're kind of suggesting, a history of organizational practices and ideological tendencies could be a way to do that, potentially. I think that's a very interesting perspective. Now I think we could shift to talk about your work, Black Flag, classic title for an anarchist book. And in this book, you explore a way of perhaps reapproaching anarchist histories in order to move away from these kind of great man theses that you've already mentioned. So perhaps you could talk a little bit about that.
Yeah, basically, what I've done in Black Flag is to firstly identify the most influential books taking into account the production in Portuguese, English, Spanish, and French. After that, investigate the bibliography of some books, theses, articles, and so on, and also with some bibliometric stuff on the internet, I arrived in 7 books. And it's important to say that they're not liberal nor Marxist books. Normally are books written by anarchists or by sympathetic authors. Mm-hmm. And what I've done is to work on a balance of this literature, to see what they're saying and their qualities and their problems, and then to identify what could be done to solve all these problems. So the structure of the book, it's basically an analysis of this bibliography, a second part that is a methodological and theoretical propose. Okay, it's some general lines. I'm suggesting some general lines for people to reapproach anarchism. And the third part, that is the main one, it's a kind of a redefinition of anarchism, a redefinition of the main debates, of the main currents, and of the of its main great lines and so on. And I do that based in authors and organizations, about 80 authors and organizations of the whole world since the first international in the 19th century up to today, you know. Mm-hmm. So because one of the problems I identificate in this 7 main books on anarchism is that, firstly, that they are Eurocentric. Mm. They focus on the history of anarchism in the North Atlantic, you know, so maybe Western Europe and United States. And so that's the history of anarchism, and all the theoretical generalizations are made with this X, you know. So what I've done is to expand this territory, let's say, looking also to Latin America, and there is a lot of interesting stuff in Latin America. So the history of anarchism in Mexico is incredible. Mm. The history of anarchism in Cuba, it's incredible. Here in South America, we have Argentina, Uruguay, Brazil, and a lot of interesting experiences. If we look to Africa, we will find a lot of interesting contexts, like in Egypt, in South Africa. Okay, if we look to Asia, we will find incredible experiences in Korea, in Japan, in China, or even if we look to Australia in general, we will find some interesting stuff there. So, what we're discovering is that, in fact, this Eurocentric perspective had private us to see the whole anarchist history and to understand anarchists in a global perspective, let's say. And then with this global perspective, we could also work in terms of time perspective.
Mm.
Okay, so my proposal there, and I'm working together with other researchers, mainly Lucien van der Walt and Rafael Viana da Silva, it's another Brazilian researcher, and basically our idea is to expand these focus in terms of geography, and in terms of time, we propose that instead of doing like Peter Marsh, for example, in this Demanding the Impossible, that maybe we'll try to use that Kropotkin's approach, that to it's possible to look for anarchism in the whole history, you know. Our proposal is to start later, okay, mm-hmm. So our starting point is on First International,
mm-hmm.
Okay, mainly in the context of the end of 1860s, okay, and from that to expand the universe up to today,
mm-hmm.
Because normally what we identified is that these common histories ends in the Spanish Revolution,
mm-hmm.
And then only mentions sometimes the experience of May 68,
mm.
To say that, as George Woodcock puts it, it was anarchism last breath,
mm-hmm.
You know. What we discover studying other regions and other times is that we had, for example, here in Latin America, a huge movement in Uruguay, okay, that was promoted by the Uruguayan Anarchist Federation. This federation was founded in 1956, but after 63 there was a clash, and the main group that remained in the federation had a really interesting and huge influence on the worker movement and in the struggle against the dictatorship then. Okay, so these 10 years from 63 to 73, the Uruguayan Anarchist Federation developed a huge strategy inside the unions, a second main force inside the unions in Uruguay. Okay, first revolutionary force, because the first one was the Communist Party, mm-hmm. With a clear reformist perspective.
Mm-hmm.
And in the armed struggle, the second great political force with an organization called Organização Revolutionary Popular Organization 33 Oriental, so trying to translate, it's OPR 33, it's the name. Okay, it's an anarchist organization, guerrilla organization, developed to interfere in the political field by the armed struggle, and it was also the second political force in this field.
Mm-hmm.
The Tupamaros was the first one, and then the second, this anarchist political force. So this is an experience that normally we do not see on the books,
mm-hmm.
And it's really important. And it shows a lot of things. I could give a lot of other examples like that, but it shows that anarchism is important outside Europe and outside the United States. It shows that the case of the Spanish Revolution is not the case of an exceptionality.
Mm.
This is another thesis of the main study, saying that what happened in Spain, mm. was unique. And anarchism converted in some huge mass movements quite few times on history and so on.
Mm.
So we could identify that it's not just only in Uruguay, but also in Mexican Revolution, also in the revolution among between 1929 and 1932 in Manchuria, in Korea,
mm.
It's also the Spanish Revolution, it's the revolution in Ukraine, okay, mainly from 1919 on, okay, the Machinovicina experiment and so on, and also a lot of other contexts and episodes that anarchism will show that it can convert into mass movements and to promote a lot of revolutionary projects and so on. So this example I gave shows that anarchism in America, in Latin America, is important. Then there is a mass influence that is completely important. There is a an articulation of this mass strategy and armed struggle strategy, and that the problem with the history of anarchism is not in the history itself, but normally in the perspective of the historians.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, looking just to France, you could say that after and even in France, I think we have some new books showing that this this information is not correct, that anarchism lacks presence and so on from the 30s to the 60s,
mm-hmm.
and then after the 60s is completely dead, let's say.
Mm.
What we are seeing is that, yes, globally, up to the 30s, okay, there is a really huge influence. After, we have a movement of this wave is kind of going down, but we can note a lot of influence, including today, in a lot of movements. If we will analyze like the Brazilian 2013 movement, okay, that's a really huge protest movement and so on, there is a great influence of anarchist practices there.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not using here anarchist in the sense of all the researchers that say that everything that is libertarian, okay, it's necessarily anarchist.
Mm.
I say we can track and to see, for example, how anarchists influenced the Passe Livre movement.
Mm.
Okay, and so how, let's see, the anarchist practices that used to be promoted in the anti-globalization movement here in Brazil in the end of the 90s, but especially in the beginning of the 2000s.
Mm.
Okay, how this influence, in fact, have a great impact on Passe Livre movement, and so this practice of grassroots democracy and a lot of interesting features of this social movement have it surely it's not an anarchist movement, but
mm.
anarchism, yes, has a presence and has an influence there.
Mm-hmm.
So the proposal of the book is to criticize, okay, these problems, and I can talk on the main problems just for you to know. I identified basically seven problems with this main studies on anarchism. The first one, the restrict quantity of authors and episodes
mm-hmm.
evaluated. So a lot of books will define anarchism using like Bakunin and Kropotkin, and like Spanish Revolution and Russian Revolution, this is anarchism.
Mm.
Okay, so all the generalization is being done using a really restrict databases, you know.
Mm-hmm.
The second problem we already talked about is the almost exclusive focus on Western Europe and United States.
Mm.
The third one, this focus on great men and the common using of this history of great men or history from above,
mm.
you know. The fourth problem, the anti-historical approaches, you know. Let's give an example. people start to define anarchism by analyzing the word anarchy. Okay, you can start with that, but in fact, you cannot define an ideological tradition of 150 years by a reflection on the meaning of the word in Greek and so on. But also in the self identification of anarchists, because a lot of works use that. Okay, if someone identifies itself, itself with anarchism, so it's part of the anarchist tradition. But what we're saying is that okay, there is a historical tradition, there is a continuity, there is some elements that constitutes the heart of this ideology in the history. Okay, so we have to compare. If someone says, okay, I'm anarchist, but I'm doing everything contrary to this historic tradition, maybe you should not consider this person anarchist. And also the opposite, let's say James Guillaume, the French member of the Bakuninist Alliance, never used the word anarchist because he said he preferred other as Bakunin, but Bakunin in the end of his life start using anarchist and other similar words, but Guillaume never did that, okay? He preferred collectivist, revolutionary socialist, and so on. So, won't you include Guillaume in the anarchist canon because he didn't use this word, and will you include other people that calls themselves anarchists but has almost nothing in common to the historical tradition? So that's a problem. The fifth problem I identified is some theoretical approaches without historical basis, and also the contrary. Okay, a lot of historical studies being done without theoretical basis. What I'm putting here is the necessity to work with theory and history together. Our proposal is to finish this kind of idiot competition among sciences. You know, the historians saying that social scientists are only worried with general abstract stuffs and taking not the historic features into consideration, and the social scientists saying that historians are just looking for particularities and small things, and this cannot be used to explain general stuff and so on. So our proposal is exactly to conciliate theory and history, and to give like historians a kind of a theoretical approach, and to give for those who work with social theory historic perspective, and to work not with this abstract theories, but to promote this. Okay, so the sixth problem, the ignorance of what we're calling the social vectors of anarchism. Okay, so we consider that normally the main social vector of anarchism was syndicalism. So there is a lot of studies that looks for the anarchist word, the anarchist title, and then you will find that maybe in some newspapers, in some schools, in some groups, but let's say in Brazil, the main project of the anarchists was to build syndicalism, and then you won't find inside the unions the name anarchist. And there is a lot of studies that just ignore this main part of the anarchist work, let's say, because there is not the word anarchist there. And then that's another complex problem, but it's to understand this relation between anarchism and syndicalism. If we observe the main part of anarchists' history, anarchists work inside the unions, promoting a kind of unionism, a kind of syndicalism that does not have the objective to transform this union or all these workers into anarchists. So a lot of historians just take it out, and so we'll discuss anarchism by their minority activities and just ignoring their main field of acting. And last one, the seventh problem, is the definitions of anarchism completely inadequate, that in fact does not make possible for us to understand the common features of this movements of these people around the world, or even to understand the difference between anarchism and other ideologies. Mm-hmm. Here, I say anarchism a lot of time is defined in terms of anti-statism. Mm-hmm. There is one of these studies I take into account in my book. We'll compare those considered the main anarchists, and we'll arrive in the conclusion that the similarity between this seven major anarchists are just the opposition of the state in the future. Mm-hmm. And then, this is a really interesting case. I won't talk too much, but it's a study done in 1900s by Paul Altsbacher. Mm-hmm. And there is it's a really interesting study for that time, and basically he compares those seven major anarchists identified by some reference people, let's say. Okay, so basically he will compare Benjamin Tucker, Tolstoy, Godwin, Stirner, Bakunin, Kropotkin, and so on. Mm-hmm. And he will arrive to this conclusion that the only similarity among all those thinkers were this was this opposition to the state in the future. Mm-hmm. And then we could say there is someone that is not anarchist there, or we could include all Marxists as part of anarchism. Mm. Okay, so there is a lot of logical problems as well there. And we will propose a lot of some methodology, some theoretic features and so on to deal with this problem. Mm-hmm. That's basically what I'm doing here in the book. Or the proposal is to restart the discussion with a different approach. Mm-hmm. So it's interesting because in my point of view it's more current and so on, but at the same time it's difficult because you have you have to discuss with a huge bibliography, and you have to deconstruct a lot of things that are being repeated for a lot of years. So it's a distinct project, but I think we have some ways here, or some. It's not a final work or something like that, but it's a proposal to study or to restart studying anarchism most appropriately.
Okay, so you're already moving in the direction of these contemporary themes, so maybe we should start to talk about these a little bit more. So since the recent impeachment of President Dilma Rousseff, and this has been seen by many on the left, and herself included, as a political coup orchestrated by the now president, Michel Temer. I wondered, can you give a response to these events and maybe talk about how anarchists here in Brazil, but also internationally, have responded?
Basically, for us to understand what is going on in Brazil, we have to understand that this whole process started in 2013 with that protest wave that was started by independent and left-wing movements. But basically, what we have is that the press, failing to end or to ignore these movements, starts to dispute the political direction of this movement. And as the movement is going on, and especially after the biggest conquest of this movement, that was the reduction in the price of the public transportation, it emerges a really social basis of a conservative right-wing population here in Brazil.
Mm.
Okay, but basically, this contradiction in 2030 that we could consider left-wing, but a more independent left-wing, and PT was not in this this independent left against a new right that is emerging there. Basically, what is going on is that this conflict that we could consider a left versus right conflict is being transformed in the next years in a conflict of this right wing will be transformed into what we call here anti-PT movement. Okay, it goes from these center-right parties like PSDB up to fascists, okay? And the other side, the Workers' Party would start doing this discourse of, oh, the right wing is emerging, we have to unite everything. And despite all the positions, what occurs is that the Workers' Party, with this discourse of it's the need to unite the left and everything, transform this left-wing camp in what we can characterize as the governist camp. So the main conflict we see up to the impeachment, up to the coup, is a conflict between this anti-PT sector and the governist sector. Because for us, this governance sector cannot be characterized as a left-wing movement, workers' movement, or something like. Okay, so this is a conflict between these two blocks, let's say. And in these two blocks, there is nothing or there is few involving workers or few involving really mass base and concerning the workers' movement. Okay, we consider that this is a conflict, an elite conflict, okay, with different external relations perspective. So governance, this perspective of South-South relation, political relation with Latin American countries, with Africa, with China, with India, and so on. And this other bloc, the coupist bloc, with this alignment to the United States that it's, okay, that it's great. Then, in both sides, we have, in fact, the whole of the great companies. Basically, during the what we call here a lulismo, this model of capitalist gesture of the state, okay, implemented by Lula and also continued by Dilma, especially in his first mandate, okay, this model, and it's a class conciliation model. Okay, what is this? The basically features of this model, continuing to give privileges and profits for all the the superior classes, and insert the poor people, mm-hmm. mainly by consumption.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, it's not a political strategy of political education, of strengthening the unions or the social movements and so on. It's an important insertion, but an insertion by the power of consumption.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that was the strategy of Lulism. But with the internal political, the external political crisis of 2008,
mm-hmm.
that was like controlled by Lula with this injection of public funds in the market, mainly by the social programs and also by other incentives to the industry and so on.
Mm-hmm.
He could like postpone the results of this crisis here in Brazil. So for us to understand the coup, it's important to say that when this model ends, and this model ends because the money starts to disappear.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so the most important feature of this problem is that the problem of exportation that Brazil does with agricultural products and mm-hmm. minerals,
mm-hmm.
you know, for India and for China, and so that's the dynamics of the economic crisis arriving here. But basically, we have less money,
mm-hmm.
and then it becomes necessary to choose how we would manage this money. Let's
mm-hmm.
say Lula was trying to give for the superior classes and for the oppressed classes, for workers, and trying to work with this model. And then this is the beginning of the coup, let's say.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so we have all the enterprises going. They were aligned to PT, going to the other side. Okay, we have this international element that the United States like stimulating a lot of agents there. Okay, we have also the parties. Okay, we have the right wing parties, the PSDB, the DEM, that is creating this new right wing movement in Brazil, and basically PT left with this with his party, with this political parties that works with them normally, PCdoB, some others, and some social movements. But the problem is that PT, exactly in his recent history, has worked in the last 20 years at least to direct all their efforts to elections.
Mm.
And so they, like we say here, that they throw water
mm-hmm.
in social struggle, in unions, and neighbor movements, and students' movements, and so on. So,
mm-hmm.
so in fact, this movement lack of concrete base, you know. So, and also an important element is that this new right, stimulated by the press, could in fact generate a social base that probably you saw at the street, that give the legitimacy
mm-hmm.
that the coup needed.
Absolutely.
Or I agree with the sociologist that gave an explanation, saying that the whole of the media was really important, because here in Brazil we didn't have an open right wing.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, 5 years ago it was impossible for you to imagine someone going to the streets defending like the dictatorship.
Mm.
And now this is possible.
Mm.
That was something people talked privately,
mm.
but it was considered publicly, politically wrong,
mm.
you know. But the press had a hold, a really important, to transform this sense of a feeling that already existed, because this explanation that the media transformed people into conservatives is completely wrong. People were conservatives, and the Workers' Party is also guilt of that because it abandoned completely the social tessiture in many camps, just struggling for votes. Okay, so these social feud is mainly formed not only by press but also by Protestant conservative churches.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so you had this right-wing feeling, but manifesting privately, and the media transformed this sense of guilt, of something that I think is politically incorrect and something, into a sentiment of pride that I'm fighting against corruption. So this element of fighting against corruption, this was the main element to transform this conservative approach into a political banner, and people start to go to the streets, and that's a complex stuff, but in general lines was that. And then basically the Workers' Party were not functioning well to the new, to the greater enterprises, bankings, and this new bureaucracy and so on. Mm-hmm. So they decided just to take PT out of the power.
Mm.
I say that we consider that this was a political coup because in fact there was no any reason for that. But in fact, with a huge impact on workers.
Mm.
So we considered this a coup, and we decided to promote struggles against the coup. But our preoccupation as anarchists is that to deal with the coup has nothing to do with reinforcing the strategy of Workers' Party.
Mm.
That's the problem. And when you say what anarchists were doing, and everybody tried to build a third alternative when this conflict transformed into these anti-PT sector and governance sector, but all the tries to build a third alternative failed.
Mm.
This conflict was so huge that it kind of capitalized everything. So the point we're putting here is that taking into account that there was a coup and that there is a sector really conservative and promoting liberal reforms and so on, this will be a catastrophe for the workers.
Mm.
But what Workers' Party did, especially in unions and social movements and student movements and in the society as a whole, it's also something really complicated.
Mm-hmm.
I say, when we start to think what we could do inside unions, inside social movements and so on, everything is destroyed, and it was destroyed by them.
Final question. If there was any time in history that you could travel to, where would you like to go, and when?
I would like to travel to the first international congresses after the foundation of the organization in 1964, but mainly in the context of the development of worker movements in Europe from the 66, 67, 68, up to the 70s. I love that that context, and I think a lot of interesting stuff happened there.
Perhaps you could also influence them to make them not so Eurocentric in their outlook, perhaps,
yeah,
hopefully.
In fact, I think that Eurocentric is more the perspective of the historians and not so much the actors of this history, you know. If you see an actor like Malatesta, he traveled to South America,
absolutely,
to Africa,
absolutely,
to North America, and so on, and he was never there as a as an European that will tell them what to do and so on. So I think when we're people normally say, okay, anarchism is Eurocentric. I say, no, I do not think anarchism is a global ideology. What I think is Eurocentric is the perspective of the historians that retract or that study anarchism.
Mm-hmm. All right, well, thank you, Felipe.
Thank you very much.